So that essentially gets us to where we are. But the church continues to change and develop new histories, so that by in the rest of the 19th century, you get an abandoning of that temple idea, the St. Martin in the Fields idea, and the substitution of a new version of Gothic, Borden-Batten Gothic style, and then everything breaks loose and you have modernism coming in and creating a mess, a great blooming, buzzing confusion of people trying different ideas, and we'll run briefly through those. There, this is a painting done for John Soane, who was the architect of the Church Commissioners Board in 1825, showing that you all had to have the standard plan for an Anglican church, which is the basilica and a recessed entry and a tower over the front door. But it didn't have to be classical like this one. Those are those columns in antis that we just saw in the Methodist church. It could also be Gothic. We could go back to the Gothic, and we have our choice. You can have your church board meet and decide what flavor your church is going to be. And that becomes a great radical idea in architectural history. This is a painting done by a New York architect in the 1840s describing the crisis in architecture of the time. It's called the Architect's Dream, and it has the architect sitting here with all of classical history to draw on for inspiration, but he's turning his back and looking across the harbor at the country of the pointed firs from which the Gothic spire is rising with the sunrise coming through it. And so he's now ignoring the classical and going to the Gothic. And this is that architect in 1814, 30 years earlier, acting as clerk of the works for the classical architect Asher Benjamin on the New Haven Green, building this church and commissioned by the Episcopalians next door on the same New Haven Green in the same summer of 1814 to build the latest thing in church architecture, which is Gothic. So you have Gothic and classical going head-to-head between the two major denominations in New England, the Episcopalians versus the Congregationalists. And in Maine, we do the same thing. This is also in the early part of the 19th century. This is in Phillips, up above Farmington. This is a sort of classic meeting house with the two doors and with a square tower over the top like your church is here. And then this is a Gothic church in East Machias by a Canadian architect who has snuck over the border to bring this new Gothicism into Maine. And he's complicated the door situation by providing three doors so that you can either have the bishop's door in the middle, or you can have the men and women on the sides, or you can just have it be a free-for-all. But it's Gothic. The first major Gothic church, again with three doors, that we have is in Gardner in 1819, where the Gardner family brings in the Bishop of Connecticut's son, who is the preacher here, who also gave the sermon at Trinity Church New Haven's inauguration. So he's a fan of the Gothic, and he does his own homegrown Gothic in Gardner. And the Gardner family has their house burned down, and they build the first Gothic house in Maine. Well, not the first, but one of the first. At, curiously, the exact time that the Houses of Parliament burned down in England, so suddenly New England is back to its adherence to England, and we're following in lockstep. And A.J. Downing is the apostle of the Gothic. He says Gothic is morally more correct because it's not imitation marble, it's real wood. And he says, we greatly prefer vertical to horizontal boarding, not only because it's more durable, but because it has an expression of truthfulness which the other has not. The main timbers that enter into the frame of a wooden house are vertical, and hence vertical boarding properly signifies a wooden house. And it is incorrect in so far as regards truthfulness of construction to show horizontal lines on the weather boarding of a wooden wall as it would be to mark vertical lines on the outside of a brick wall. So it's morally correct. You can't do it otherwise. He's, of course, completely wrong in the sense that there are just as many horizontal floor beams as there are vertical wall studs. So it's not true, but it's his position, and he's sticking to it. And that's how we get this board and batten, which we see in churches. And, of course, we get things like the Smithsonian in the Gothic style. But we get Richard Upjohn coming to Maine and ending up building Trinity Church, New York, on the basis of having got the job to build St. John's Episcopal in Bangor in this new Gothic style. And he gets called back to do the Bowdoin Chapel and First Church in Brunswick, which is Borden-Batten Gothic church. And while he's in Brunswick, he is also approached by the Episcopalians, so he's building three churches, one in the Romanesque stone style with round arches, and two in the board and batten style, one with Gothic arches for the Episcopalians and one with square windows for the Congregationalists. And one of the nice examples of board and batten is this floating church on the Delaware River, which was built as an Episcopal chapel for the seamen, and so you could tow the church to where they were. And it was an idea of taking advantage of the fact that these were a light wooden structure instead of a heavy stone structure. And apparently it was the inspiration for the hymn, Fling Out the Banner, which is not one that's in our hymnals at this point. And this is the interior of First Church Brunswick. So this is a Gothic-derived wooden frame based on those hammer beams that we saw with angels on them in England, the hammer beam churches. And we get an example of hammer beam Gothic in Maine as a result of this enthusiasm. And that's First Church after it gets its new steeple. But the other style is the Romanesque style of southern Germany, which comes in because Queen Victoria's husband, Prince Albert, is from South Germany, where, as an architecture buff, he's fallen in love with the architecture of northern Italy, the Lombard architecture, which is characterized by having stone walls with round Roman arches in it and having big overhangs on the roof and brackets holding up those overhangs. So this becomes called the Italianate, or the Lombard, or the Rundbogenstil, which means round arch style, and we start using it for churches. And so we get churches in Maine, including this one, which, with their round arches and circular windows and brackets holding up the roof, which this one does not because the original trim here is the Greek Revival trim from its first incarnation, are Italianate churches on the style of Prince Albert. And this, we of course have the great organ recess here and the round arches on the side with the stained glass window. And we have the other churches though, like St. Paul's, you can see the brackets under the roof, which are the true hallmark of the Italianate style. And West Waldoborough, the same thing. These could be by the same builder, the same time being built for different church groups. This is the other great flurry of new churches. Winslow's Mills has this Gothic sort of pointed arch porch, but then has the lids and brackets of the Italianate. And the bell tower added 1905, you see, has gone over to the shingle style with this sort of hula skirt of wood shingles around the top base of the steeple. What the rest of the church goes on and does is flirt with the Romanesque style of Richardson, Henry Hobson Richardson, who thinks that we've run out of Gothic, we've run out of Byzantine, we've run out of classical. What we need to do is come up with a new style, and he decides it'll be Spanish Romanesque from the 9th century on the basis of a trip he made to Spain. So Trinity Church Boston becomes Spanish Romanesque. And that and the shingle style things that he does as houses breed a whole generation of shingle style cottages, largely in this area done by the Episcopal Church as part of their summer colonies of shingle style houses. And this particularly spectacular one was in York, and apparently didn't last very long. It was built in 1885, enlarged 3 years later, and then destroyed. They don't say by whom and when, but it's clearly not there now. But that's church building in Maine in the 19th century. And not far from here in Newcastle, we have great examples of the new Gothic style that comes out of this. The strict English Gothic coming over from England, Henry Vaughan, and himself doing the high color decorations and stenciling on the ground the altar of this because he couldn't get anybody to do it. And then going on to Washington to build the Washington Cathedral, which I grew up in, so it's sort of coming full circle, which is strict Gothic, following the rules of the 14th century England, because that's the only proper way to build a church, is to do it right and thoroughly in the way they did it in the 14th century. And Rob Adams Cram writes a book called Church Building, which he advocates doing exactly that. I will give you a couple of last quotes from that. He says that basically, a church is a house of God, and you can't do anything cheaply in something that is built for God. He says, all things fail in a measure to show the deep devotion of men and their
solemn knowledge of the majesty of that presence that she mentioned her brother in. There is a scant kinship between this spirit and that which prompts and governs the construction of contemporary churches. Were it restored, if only in small measure, men would understand clearly the fatal error of the modern principle, realize that no tricks, no imitations, no cheapness, no pretenses of any kind are tolerable in a Christian church, and the admission of those things in the temple of the living God is blasphemy. Instead of the cheap and tawdry structures of shingles and clavers or flimsy brick and stone veneer, doomed to very desirable decay, we should have once more solid and enduring temples that even by reason of our artistic backwardness could not at first compare with the noble work of the Middle Age, would at least take place within the point of honor instead of standing as now a perpetual reminder of our meanness and hypocrisy. So that was what gave us Washington Cathedral and its eye on the other kinds of solid structures. But the rest of it was free reign. The Catholic Church discovers Byzantium, and they're not going to do either Roman buildings or Byzantine or Gothic buildings, saying that they're Byzantine buildings. That's in Paris. This is Westminster Cathedral, which is a Byzantine Catholic cathedral in London. Made of red brick and white Portland stone, and therefore come to be called the Streaky Bacon Cathedral. There's Denmark, using a traditional stepped gable to create a new church. And then in Barcelona, you get Gaudí creating the incredible Sagrada Familia based on Gothic principles. And then in America, you get Frank Lloyd Wright throwing everything out the window and saying, let's build a square box. Of course, this is a Unitarian church, so it's got a reason for having a square box. But people thought it was a slaughterhouse. And then in Coventry, you get the Gothic cathedral bombed out of the water and replaced with a modern concrete shell, but doing the same old job of being a basilica church with the light coming through the stained glass and manipulating itself through the material. And then the occasional sculpture. This is one of the most important architects of the 20th century, Le Corbusier. For his church, he goes back to prehistoric times to find the earliest form of religious expression and finds it in the stone and dolmens of Ireland. And so he says, I'm going to build a church that is just as heavy and uncomfortable looking as that. So he creates this great massive concrete lid on top of the thin stucco wall. And when you go into it, it's a dark cave with holes in the wall that remind you of being in this subterranean.